31st night, we also asked people to give thanks. You know, some of you who missed the 31st night, the tree has nothing special. It has a lot of things hanging to it that are special. We asked people to give thanks to God for 2015, what God has done, and asked them to write it on the stick-on notes and keep it to the branches. We also asked people to write a dream that they have for 2016. In one word for 2016, just one word, I want to launch a business or something like that. You know, I want to get rid of a habit. Just one word to tell, this is my dream for 2016. I also wrote, I had a dream for this year, 2016. Personally, I'm not going to share that with you, but I have a dream that I want to see being fulfilled this year. But I also have a dream as a pastor of Capstone for this year. This year, I want to see our church give birth to another church. Is that a good thing? All right. Can somebody appreciate that? Yes. This year we are praying, and I'm praying. The pastoral team started dreaming already that we want to see another church being birthed through our church. So that's our dream for 2016. And I'm sure some of you have written down your own dreams. I've seen some dreams, sorry for prying it, but I've seen some dreams that talked about getting promotion, talked about launching a business, talking about financial increase. So there are many dreams that are, you know, that people have, are dreaming right now for 2016. And I'm sure you have a lot of dreams for 2016. But the real question is, what is the dream of your life? Not for 2016, but for your life itself. And out of that question is born the new series that we're going to begin today. We're going to call the series The Dream Catchers. I could have named it many names, but I purposefully picked up this title, The Dream Catchers. I was inspired by a book that I was reading before I left to Australia called The Dream Giver. I'm going to talk about that. But while reading that book, God started inspiring something to share with you during this new year, this January. So over the course of next 8 weeks or 9 weeks, we will look at many things about dream catching. Why dream catching? The reason I titled it as dream catching fulfillment is because I actually think that there is a difference between catching the dream and then seeing it being fulfilled. I'll explain that to you. Let's say this year, I want to see my business flourish, or I want to become rich. There's a dream of somebody who dreams of becoming rich in his life. That is a dream to achieve. I want to be a multimillionaire, or I want to be a CEO of a company. I want to become a manager in my company, whatever. One dream, you have a dream that you want to see fulfilled in your life. But the real question is, why do you want that to happen in your life? Why do you want to become a multimillionaire? Why do you want to become the CEO of a company? Why do you want to become a manager? If you can answer the why question, then you caught the dream. The what comes later. The what is about fulfillment. But why is catching the dream? Many of us don't know the why. That's why our dreams die in the beginning. We don't really know why you want to do something in your life, why we want to achieve something in our lives. Why do I want to become a multimillionaire? Why do I want to become a pastor? Why do I want to become a minister? Why do I want to do something in my life? If I don't know the why, then what? Answering the what is useless. That's why I don't want to talk about the fulfillment. I will talk about it towards the end. But I think the question is really, why do I dream? And it's all about that you would see the story of the Bible is every person's story in the Bible is that they had a journey that they took in catching the dream. Once they caught the dream, the what answered for itself. How do I fulfill the dream? Automatically God answered. But it took time for them to catch the dream. And that's the journey that I want to take you through this series, to catch your dream. There's a story in the Bible that I want you to look at. But do you know that on the 31st night, we gave a gift to everybody in the church? It's a new Bible. Did you get your Bibles, those of you who got it? Can you show me your Bible? This is a heavy Bible. You need to carry it. All right? From this Sunday, we are not going to display the verses on the screen. So if you didn't get the Bible today, you might as well sit beside somebody who has a Bible, because you're not going to see that on the screen. All right? If you don't have a Bible and you want the Bible, at the end of the service, we have them ready for you at the welcome table. Go pick up as many as you want for everybody in the family. For you, for your spouse, for your children, as many as you want. We have them as a gift for you. Do you like the gift? It's a good gift. The reason we gave this gift is because we didn't want to give you promise cards. We wanted to give you the 7,000 promises that are in the Bible at once. So take all the 7,000 promises in the Bible, find them. Dr. Rajkumar, when he was here for our anniversary, he talked about a Bible study plan. That means you can actually finish the Bible 5 times in one year, one single year. He has a study, a Bible study plan that he gave it to me. And I will give it to those who are really serious about finishing your Bible. All right? At the end of the service, you come and meet me and I'll give you. I don't want to give it to everybody. Because sometimes you have the Bible, you have the study plan, but you never open it. Or you probably go through January and then stop it. That's why if you're serious, you really want to know the word, please meet me at the end of the service and I'll give you. That's a promise from me. I'll give the reading plan to you. But this is a brilliant Bible. It's a new translation. It's called English Standard Version. Easy to understand. It also has notes down below so that you can read and understand certain words that you don't understand. Understand the context in which the passage is written. It's free. Please feel free to pick up one at the end of the service. I want you to turn your Bibles to Judges chapter 6. This is a passage from which, when I heard the first time in 92 in a youth camp, I heard a speaker speaking about how Gideon was trying to run away from God. It was this passage that convicted me to come back to Jesus. It was the same passage that called me to serve God. It was the same passage that called me back again when I ran away from God, ran away from my ministry call, and ran away from God. The same passage spoke to me again and brought me back to God. And I think it's apt for me to start from this passage. Just 2 verses as the beginning for this series. Chapter 6, verses 11 and 12. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the terebinth at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abizrite, while his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him and said to him, "The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor." The Lord is with you, O mighty man of valor. Now, I'm going to talk about Gideon next week, not today, but just want to focus on only one thing. The angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon. That's all I wanted to focus on today. The angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon. I've thought about it long and hard. Why, of all the people, Gideon? Why not somebody else? Why not his father? Why not his brother? Why not somebody else? Why Gideon? Why did God pick up Gideon? Why does God pick up people like you and like me? Why does God pick ordinary people to do great things for him? That was the question that kept running in my head, and finally I couldn't answer it. So I'm not going to give you an answer today, but I understood this one truth, that God gives big dreams to ordinary people from unfamiliar places for his glory. Remember this. This is your lesson for today. That God gives big dreams to ordinary people like you, like me, from unfamiliar places, insignificant places, useless backgrounds. He gives big dreams to ordinary people like us from unfamiliar places so that he can be glorified through us. That's why God gives dreams to us. This morning, I want to send you back only with that, that God has a dream for you. That God has a dream for you. You got to understand that. You got to allow that to get into your head so that you can take action steps after this. You see, the book Dream Giver, from which the series was inspired, is a two-part book. The first part of the book talks about, the book looks like this. It's available on Amazon.in. You can get a clean Kindle version or a book. This is a good book to get. The book, the first part of the book talks about a parable of an ordinary guy. It's a 60-page parable, so obviously I cannot read that for you, but I'm going to try and condense it without compromising the integrity of the story, just to give you what the story is all about. The parable is all about. The parable is inspired by the journey of Israelites from Egypt to the land of Canaan. You see, they moved from Egypt to their promised land. They caught hold of the dream. But the dream got fulfilled only when they entered into the promised land. Do you get the picture? So they caught the dream in this journey, 40-year wild journey. They laid hold of what God actually has for them. And once they understood that, then it was easy for them to fulfill the dream in the promised land. So it is necessary for us to understand, why do we dream? Why does God have a dream for me and for you? It talks about an ordinary guy living in a familiar land with nothing special to do. He is just an ordinary. He has a usual job. Every morning he gets up the same way he got up yesterday and the day before yesterday. Every day he would do the same things that he would do before he goes to the office. He goes to his usual office, usual job, sit down, does the thing that he usually does. And that has been his routine all his life. From the time he knows, from the time he's able to think, his life has been just as usual as it was yesterday, as it was last year. It was just an ordinary life. This ordinary had another ordinary as his best friend. Sometimes they would come together, just sit down, watch cricket on an ordinary TV box. Or they would just hang out together to have an ordinary Hyderabadi chai. But that's their life. It was usual. Everything is usual about it. Nothing special, nothing unfamiliar is seen in a familiar land. Some of us are in familiar land. But one day, ordinary got up with a nagging feeling. The nagging feeling is this, that there must be something I am missing in my life. There must be something else about my life. That's all. That was just that feeling of missing something was in his heart. And it grew. The more he tried to avoid it, the question became bigger and bigger. There must be something about my life. I cannot just be an ordinary. I must be something. There must be something else that I can do. There must be something else for my life. And so as he began to think about that question, one night he had a dream. It was a very small dream, but in that dream, he saw that he is going to be an extraordinary person. He's going to be somebody. He was a nobody, just an ordinary guy, but the dream showed him that he's going to become somebody. And so he got up, jolted out of this dream, got up and sat down and thought, that must be it. That must be what I'm missing in my life. a dream. I don't have a dream. I'm just living an ordinary life, doing an ordinary job, living my life as usual, as it was. I'm just missing something, and this must be it, a dream. So he thought long, hard about this dream. And another strange thing he found, that to his window of the bedroom, he saw a small feather, hanging to the windowsill. He knew it was a sign from the dream giver. Somebody had given him a dream. The dream tells him that he is going to become somebody. And that somebody is the dream giver. And he showed that sign, that it is from me. So he was extremely excited about this dream. He wanted to tell somebody about his dream. The only person he knows is his best friend, another ordinary guy. So he ran to his office, all excited, got ready, ran to his friend, and as he met him in the workplace, he shared with him his dream. You know, I've got a dream. My dream is that I'm made to do something great. Oh, that's a big dream. You are just an ordinary guy. How can you do that? Was the question that came from his best friend. So the moment his friend asked that question, ordinary immediately got discouraged. My best friend only not believing in me. What do I do now? So he comes back thinking, yeah, it is a big dream. I don't think I can do it. Goes back to his home. But there is something about the dream that always got, you know, every time he thought about the dream, there's this joy, there's this full, you know, feeling of fulfillment. That's what my life is all about. I mean, he loves his job. He loves his usual job. He doesn't have any problem with the job, but the dream is much bigger than his job. But every time he thought about the dream, it's just beautiful. That feeling, you see. But then he thought about his best friend, and then he thought about, why would I want to leave familiar and go to something that is unfamiliar? How can I do such a big thing? I don't think I can do it. Maybe not now. And so he put the dream in the back burner, got back to his usual life, ordinary life, comfortable life. Went back to the same job, kept doing the same job, kept meeting the same friends, kept watching the same cricket. But you see, the more he avoided and put the dream in the back burner, the more he grew sadder. The more he became sad, he couldn't sleep in the nights. He could see that there is this gap that is growing, this void that is growing inside his heart. He loved his job. He's getting promotions. He's getting good money. But, well, there is this deep chasm that is being created in his heart that he just couldn't get rid of. So he became sadder by day. So one day he thought, let me at least go to my parents and just talk to them about what I'm going through. So he went to visit his ordinary parents. The ordinary parents were just ordinary. Like the ordinary father was also lying down in this nice looking leather couch and watching the cricket on the ordinary box. His mother, like the ordinary mother, saw the ordinary come to home, and she was so happy, so she began to cook the ordinary chicken curry. But then he is sad, right? The ordinary, so he sat beside his ordinary father, and the father could see ordinary was sad, and asked him, what's happening? Ordinary looked at his father, and said, I don't know, I'm feeling very sad. What is the sadness about? Well, I had a dream. A dream which told me that I don't have to be ordinary, I can become somebody. That I can do extraordinary. The father looked at him and smiled and said, well, that's not a surprise. You had the dream from the time you're a child. Really? Yep. As you were growing up, you had the same dream. You really wanted to do something with your life. You really wanted to achieve something great with your life. But then, you know, as you're studying, as you started looking for a career, as you started looking for a job, and as you found job, and then as you looked for promotions, and promotions after promotions, you kind of put it in the back burner. Maybe that's why the dream giver brought it back to you. To remind you, I have a dream for you. Ordinary was surprised that this was not a new dream. It was there from his childhood. So he got up from his dad, and just as he was about to leave, dad looked at him and said, you know, don't do the same mistake that I did. Now, ordinary was more surprised. So he turned back to his ordinary father and asked him, what? His father told him, I had the same dream once. When I was young, when I had strength, I had the same dream. But you see, I've got so many things to take care of, wife, children, and job, and house, and car, and loans to pay, insurances to pay, so many things that are in my head that I put the dream beside. And slowly, my feather vanished from my windowsill. Don't do that. Because while I have everything now, I'm still sad that I couldn't do one thing that the dream giver was asking me to do. So ordinary walked away from the home. Now with this push that he got from his father, and he began to think, I don't want to make the same mistake my father made. I'm going to do something about this dream. So he went to his home, packed his suitcase, took the feather out of the windowsill, kept it in his bag, in his nice-looking suitcase, and then began his journey. Called his friend and told him, you know, dream giver has given me a new dream, a dream, and I'm going to pursue the dream. So as he began this journey from this very familiar village in which he was born, brought up, and got settled down, the familiar surroundings through that main street, as he began to walk, he's with his chest high, and he began to whistle he was so excited about the new journey that he's going to take towards his dream. He began to compose a song and whistle it. And as he began this journey, everybody on the ordinary streets, the familiar village, were watching him, and they were surprised that the ordinary was so happy, and he's actually walking away from ordinary village, the familiar village. And as he began to come to the edge of the familiar village, he began to have little uncomfortability, but then he thought, that's okay, you know, this has been so familiar, so long I've been in this place. What is unfamiliar can be little unfamiliar, right? Uncomfortable. So the song, while it had this crescendo before he actually crossed the village, began to slowly sink down because the unfamiliar territory is making him more uncomfortable. And the more uncomfortable he became in the unfamiliar territory, his song, the whistle, started going down, and going down, till he came to a point where when he turned back, he couldn't see the familiar village. All around him is just unfamiliar territory. Now he has come to a borderland. If he has to pursue his dream, he has to cross this river, which really is big. He doesn't know what to do. What kind of decision should I make? And even as he stood there, before he could even enter the borderland, he could see a wall that raised up against him. It was so big, so huge. The moment he saw the wall, his heart filled with fear. He took a step back. Man, this is going to fall. He took a step back and saw the wall, and the fear started increasing in him. What am I thinking? That's what he thought. He put the suitcase aside, sat on the suitcase, and began to think as he looked at this wall. Massive. Man, this is too big. What am I thinking? Did I really think I'm going to cross this? Maybe the dream giver was mistaken. He thought, I am good at this. Maybe he wanted to give the dream to somebody, and by mistake he gave the dream to me. I don't think I am good enough to do this. Who is going to break the wall? This is too big. I don't think I can do it. And as he began to think about it, he suddenly heard the voice of the dream giver. And the dream giver asked him, why did you stop? Did you see the wall? Yeah, I see the wall. Walk through it. Really? You must be joking. You got the wrong guy, you know. I don't think I can do this. The dream giver said, yeah, you can. I'm here. I gave you the dream. Walk through the wall. No. I don't think I can do this. I think you got the wrong guy. With saying that, he stood up, took his suitcase, started turning back to the familiar territory. And as he began to walk back to the familiar, the song bay came back again. But now the song is different. It was not the song of joy to, of an adventurer on the journey. It was more like the familiar song that he heard on the familiar TV set. And as he began to enter into the familiar territory, the uncomfortable feeling has gone away now. Because now everything is familiar. But the problem is this, that as he began to go deeper into the familiar village, his heart grew sadder again. It became sad and sad and sad. So much sadness in his heart that he put the suitcase down again, sat on the in the middle of the street. Everybody is watching him. What is he trying to do right now? So as he sat on his suitcase, he started thinking, do I take a risk and go back, walk through the wall? Or do I take the step back and walk back to home and get back to the usual job, to the familiar setting of my nice-looking MNC, sit with my best buddy and watch the same ordinary box? That was the question that he had to answer at that moment. So he's sitting there and he's thinking, should I get back to the ordinary life, or should I take a risk and go to what is unfamiliar and become somebody? Now the dream giver was not talking. He was standing beside him but not talking. He left the choice to the ordinary. What should I do? No answer. Should I take the risk? No answer. Would you help me to walk through the wall? No answer. So he thought about it long, hard, then decided, well, I'm going to take the risk. I don't want to get back to the ordinary life. It's just boring. So he got back, got up and picked up his suitcase again, and began to walk back to the wall. As he came into the unfamiliar territory, walked up to the wall, the fear came back. The fear is still there. In fact, it is doubled now. My God, I've taken a risk and I've left everything and I've come. Am I actually going to make this through? He turned back for the dream giver. At least in the familiar city, the dream giver was there. Now there is no dream giver. He can't see the dream giver. Forget about listening to him. He can't even see him around. But then he has a choice to make as he stood at the wall. He doesn't know how to get through the wall. So, well, he asked me to walk through. Let me just take a step. So he picked up his suitcase and put his step towards the wall. And lo, amazing thing happened. The wall disappeared. This wall that caused so much fear just disappeared. Just like that. And he is now at the border. But here is what happened as he came closer to the bridge that would help him to cross the river that was so big, you know, that was flowing. And as he came to the bridge, he saw three familiar faces walking up to him. It was his mother, his best friend, and the bridge owner. All three of them walked up to him and said, Are you out of your mind? Began his mother. What's wrong with you? You had such a nice job. Who asked you to quit the job? Have you gone out of your mind? Who's going to take care of your family? What happens after 2 months when you lose all the money in the bank? I know now the mother is concerned. She's right in what she's asking. He can see that, but he didn't expect it from his mom. And the questions that she kept asking him were so familiar, he didn't know what to do now. He didn't want to hurt his mom, but he needs to take his journey. He has to go and, you know, follow his dream. But the problem is, he has an unexpected opposition in front of him in the form of his mom. And he tried to explain to her, no, this is the dream that the dream giver has given, and I think he's going to help me to do. You think? What do you mean by you think? Well, he might. What do you mean by he might? Pitched in his uncle, who just appeared out of nowhere. He has never been in his life. He has never helped him. When he was jobless, his uncle was not there. But now he's pursuing his dream. His uncle appeared out of the blue. What, fellow? What are you doing? Are you going to give disrespect, bring disrespect to my family, our family? Really? Where were you when I needed a job? But then uncle was so big and so mighty, ordinary didn't know what to do. So he is struggling to answer both of them, and then his best friend came, put his arm around, took him out and said, took him away from his mom and uncle and said, you know, just get back, man. I'm there for you, you know. Let's just hang out together. Why do you want to go to something that is unfamiliar? So you have this bullying happening on one side, you have the questioning happening on the other side, and then you have this cajoling happening on one side. He ordinary didn't know what to do. So he looked up and said, dream giver, do something now. And then there, right in front of his eyes, he could see a champion sitting. It was a champion. He knew it. Because he can see champion written all over him. That is somebody who achieved his dream. So the ordinary walked up to the champion, somehow got away from them, walked up to them, and asked the champion, what do I do? So the champion actually mentored him on how to answer his mom, how to answer his uncle, and how to answer his friend. Well, I'll talk about it later on, not now. But he's got the answer, so he goes back to his unexpected opposition and convinces them that this is the dream that I need to pursue. But now there is a big problem, bigger problem than those three, the owner of the bridge itself, the guy who can actually help him cross over, is standing right in front of the bridge and saying, no way, absolutely no way. I'm not going to give you another an opportunity to get your dream done, to cross over this. I don't care what you do. Swim if you want to. I'm not going to allow you to cross the bridge. This was unexpected. He didn't expect an unexpected opposition like that. So he didn't know what to do. At last, he somehow convinced his parents. He's come to one opportunity that can actually help him to get on to his dream, and that is closed. So the only option that he's got now is to swim. If walking through the wall is one big challenge, swimming an ocean is a bigger challenge. So he's standing there looking at these waves that are now bringing more fear back into his heart. The champion appeared beside him again. said, hey, I have a gift for you. Now that you risked everything, I want to give you a gift. Now this was given to me by another champion when I was here at the same place. There it is, the boat. You don't need a bridge. You can take my boat and cross. And so he's got a boat. And he crossed over to the other side. Now that's not the end of his journey. He's got a bigger journey after that. And as he entered into completely now an unfamiliar land, there is no way he can now get back to his familiar village. There's no way. He can't get back there now. He's now on his own. No job, nobody to support. All he's got is one suitcase full of some reserves, food, water, whatever. Apart from that, there's nothing in his hand. So he's a little confident. Well, I can't see anything right now. I know it's in front of me. All looks desert, dry land and rocks. But at least I have a suitcase. I can use this food and I can use this water as a reserve. And so he began his journey. Now, how long are you going to depend on the suitcase full of food? At some point in his journey, all the reserve has gone down, vanished. He didn't have food anymore. And suitcase became a little heavy. You know, it's useless to carry that suitcase. So he took what he needed, took the feather in a small bag that he was already carrying, put the feather inside that, left the suitcase also, and began his journey in that desert, dry land. There's nothing he could see. He can't see a road. He doesn't know where to go. He knows that the dream giver has given him the dream, and this is the land through which he needs to go to the dream. But the problem is, there's no road. Where would I go? If I go to the left, will I actually reach my dream? If I go straight, will I reach my dream? If I go to the right, will I reach my dream? I don't know. But then he began to devise his own, you know, plan, and he began the journey. The problem is, he begins his journey in the morning, and by the time it is evening, he comes back to the same place he started. He knows it's the same place he started because there is a tree that is completely dry, almost dry, except that it bears little fruit. And beside it is a small pool of water. Very small, enough for him to drink. That's all. Here is the funny thing. Every morning he takes the fruit, eats it, and it's a dry tree. He takes his journey in the morning, comes back to the same place, there's a fruit again. It's never plenty, but it's enough. It's always there, the water, the fruit. So he's getting frustrated. He doesn't know what to do. And one day after you know, really trying every possible path that he could go, he just sat at the foot of the tree, not knowing what to do now. And as he sat there, he heard a voice from the top of the tree. There was a woman sitting there, and she got down. He's really frustrated, given up on everybody, because the dream giver was nowhere to be seen. He's asking every day to the dream giver, can you show me a path in which I need to go? The dream giver doesn't answer at all. Absolutely no answer from the dream giver. So he has given up on the dream giver. And as he sat there at the foot of the tree, completely exhausted, disappointed, as a failure, he sees this woman getting down and saying, dream giver sent me to help you. Who are you? My name is Faith. Dream giver had asked me to help you. I've been praying to the dream giver. Why doesn't he answer me directly? Why should he send Faith? What am I going to do with Faith? Follow me. No, I don't know you. I want the dream giver to come and talk to me. If you follow me, I can take you to the dream. No, 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 it's not you who gave me the dream. It's the dream giver who gave me the dream. He should answer me. And he was so adamant, the ordinary, because he's really tired, you know. Some of us are like that. He's really tired with God. And he's sitting there and says, I absolutely want only the dream giver to come and talk to me. And the faith looked at him and said, all right. And she began to walk. And as he sat there under that tree, and as he watched the faith slowly disappear in the horizon, he began to feel sad. At least I should have listened to the faith. As long as she was around me, there was little hope at least. Now there is no hope. So he decided he's going to follow the faith. Got up, picked up his knapsack, then began to look for the footsteps of the faith and started following. As he took his journey, following the footsteps of the faith, at some point he began to see faith somewhere in the horizon. He could see the silhouette of the faith, and then he began his pace faster, because now he sees somebody familiar, and he knows that if I can be with faith, I'll have hope, some hope. So he caught up to the faith, and faith led him to an oasis. And she asked him, once he reached to the oasis, she asked him, get into the water. That's what dream giver is saying, get into the water, come into the water. As he got into the water, all this dirt, all this pain, all the hurts that the journey brought began to heal in the water, began to be cleansed in the water. So when he came out of the water, he's completely refreshed. Absolutely. Then he heard the dream giver's voice. For the first time, after a long time, the last time he heard the dream giver's voice was before the wall. You remember? And now, after a long time, God began to talk to him. Now he told him, come into the light. So right in front of his eyes, he sees a light appear in front of him, and everything around him began to disappear, and the ordinary walked into the light. And in the light, he now could see all that hurt is gone. All that dirt is gone. All the pain is gone. All the things that made him sad, all the things that made him guilty, all the things that he has compromised on, all the things that he had messed up, just disappeared. In the light, everything became as light. Then he heard the voice from the light, come closer to me. So as he began to walk through the light, he saw himself on the top of a mount with the dream giver standing beside him. And the dream giver looked at him and told him, give me your dream. Do you know how hard I worked to get this dream up to this point? I worked so hard. You were not there. Were you there? You were not there. I was the one who was struggling there in the desert. I was the one half full of stomach, with no water around, nobody to show me any path, nobody to tell me what to do. You're asking me to give the dream back to you? Yep. Why? Because that's my dream, not your dream. Ordinary got really mad at the dream giver. How can you do that? How can you say to give back this dream that I worked so hard for? I didn't even come closer to that. You were asking me to give it back. Yep. No more answers other than that. Just give me back. So finally, after a long struggle, Ordinary buckled down on his knees and said, well, Looks like I don't have a choice. I realize it was you who brought me all through the journey. When I was going in circles, you made sure I had food every day. I had water every day, in the morning and in the evening. When I gave up completely, then you sent faith so that I can walk through the desert, following the faith. Now I see your hand all through my journey, so it must be your dream. So he gave back his dream, the feather. You see, you remember the feather? He gave the feather back to the dream giver. And as he came down off the hill next morning, and he opened his knapsack to prepare himself for the journey, the feather was back there inside with a small note attached. I love the way you surrendered. The dream is back to you. And so he took this bag, the dream. Now he felt he's fully strong. There is this power that is inside him that he knows he's strong. He knows he's powerful now. He could face any kind of trouble. And he began his journey towards his dream, the promised land. And as he began his journey, out of the blue, he began to see big giants brandishing swords, spears coming at him. A giant with a name written on it, Moneyless. Another giant written on it, Rejection. Another giant written on it, Darkness. Another giant written on it, Persecution. They began to come and fight with him. But you see, he already feels strong, right? Now he began to fight. And as he began to fight one after the other, these giants, these enemies, began to attack him from all sides. And he began to kill one after the other, to a point where he could see himself becoming weaker and weaker and weaker. He fought his heart out. He fought with all his energy, and he brought many giants down. Finally, when the giant of darkness began to surround him so that he cannot see anywhere, he started losing his strength. And as he began to lose his strength, he started crying out, "Dream giver, help me. I need help. I need you to do something." And the dream giver told him, "Leave your weapons." "What do you mean by leave my weapons? I have to fight." "Yeah, I know, but leave your weapons." "I'm using all my strength." "I know that. That's why I'm asking you to leave your weapons." "Okay, I leave my weapons. So what do I fight the giant with?" "Pick up the feather." "Really? You must be joking. How can I defeat this giant with a feather?" "Just take it out, man." So he picked up the feather, and as he wielded it, just like a sword, it actually grew into a bigger sword. A sword that he probably would never been able to get anywhere. It just appeared out of the blue. The feather actually turned into a sword, and it killed the giant of darkness in one shot. And just as the giant of darkness fell, there is the promised land standing in front of him. He could see the name written there, the promise. He knew it was his dream. At last, he's now standing in front of his dream. And the dream giver appeared beside him and said, "This is your dream. Go claim it." So as he entered inside, he began to look at so many things around him that are not right. And he began to ask the dream giver, things are not right here. You know, the dreamland looks great, but nothing is right. That's why it's your dream. You got to do something about it. What do I do? Well, you begin to do something, then I will tell you what to do. There were doubts all over his head. I know, what do I do with this? What do I do with that? How do I correct that? How do I make sure, you know, the city is back into shape? The dream giver told him, begin at the door and I'll tell you how to clean the city. And so once he bent and began to clean the front portion of the city itself, then the doubts vanished. And that's how the dream giver helped ordinary to become extraordinary. It's the same story with you and with me. It's the same story. Doesn't change. The pattern is the same. Until you catch the dream, lay hold of what Christ had laid hold of me. That's what Paul says in 1 Corinthians. I lay hold of what Christ had laid hold of me. Unless you lay hold of what Christ has laid hold for you, you will not see the dream come into fulfillment. You got to catch your dream. Got to catch your dream. But it's not easy. There are 7 hurdles that the ordinary faced in his journey. All of them won't come at one time. Each one comes as you take the journey. The first hurdle was excuses. Am I good enough to do it? Of self-confidence, you know, I don't think I can do this. The second hurdle is the fear. If I take the risk and get into unfamiliarity, I don't know what is going to happen to me. Will I ever get back? Will I be able to gain what I lost? Fear is the second hurdle that ordinary had to cross. Unexpected opposition is the third hurdle that he had to cross. He didn't expect that to happen to him. He didn't expect his best friend would come up to him and try talk him down. He didn't expect his uncle to come and tell him, what are you trying to do, you know? He didn't even expect the bridge owner would stop him from actually crossing. The only opportunity that he's got to fulfill his dream is blocked by the bridge owner. Unexpected opposition was a hurdle he had to cross. He had to cross failures and disappointment, dry land. The land of dryness, all around him is just wasteland. Everything that he does is in failure. Everything that he's trying to do ends up in disappointment. Have you ever faced that? So he had to take the help of faith in order to cross the wasteland, the failures and disappointments. And then he enters into the time of refreshing with God, this amazing fellowship with God, with the dream giver. It was so good, man. But the dream giver wants you to get rid of your selfishness. Man, crossing selfishness is one of the most difficult things to do. Crossing that hurdle that says, it's mine, and give it back to God. Nah, that's not going to happen with us. You see, I didn't mention something. All through the journey, at every hurdle, ordinary faced another ordinary who had the same dream like him, but gave up in the process and went back. He said, nah, I can't do this. I can't do this. I can't do this. So when he faced the giants, the fifth one, the enemies that tried to destroy you, the sixth one, when he tried to, the enemies that are trying to destroy you, he realized that he cannot use his own strength. He needs to depend on the dream giver's strength. And only then he can defeat the enemies and cross over. Only after that, finally realizing the dream is not mine, the strength is not mine, the path I don't decide, I just follow the dream giver, only then he caught hold of the dream. And just as he caught the dream, the final hurdle that came into his mind is doubt. How am I going to do this? How am I going to do this? We will talk about it over the next 7 weeks. We will cross each hurdle. Some of you are halfway. Some of you did not even began the journey. Some of you did not see the weather on your windows, the feather on your windowsill. You didn't see the dream still yet. So I'm going to help you find your dream. I'm going to help you with the help of the Holy Spirit, of course, to pursue that dream, to catch the dream. Three principles, three things that I want you to remember before you go. The first one, you will become what you see. Don't worry, I'll explain that next week. You will become what you see. Number two, you will get what you always got if you do what you always done. Oh, you are thinkers. You can think about it, right? That's why this is the assignment for you throughout this week. You will get what you always got if you do what you've always done. You will get the same result that you got in 2015, in 2016, if you do the same thing that you've done in 2015, back again in 2016. You will get what you always got if you do what you've always done. Number three. The third thing that you need to remember is this. You cannot let what you cannot do interfere with what you can do. Write it down. Think through. You cannot let what you cannot do interfere with what you can do. If you can understand these three principles, the journey from next week is going to be amazing. As you start thinking through these three truths, you will become what you see. You will get what you've always got if you do what you've always done. Number three. What's the third one? You cannot let what you cannot do interfere with what you can do. Think about this. These are the truths that needs to get into dreamers, into your heads. And you will be an amazing dream catcher. Making dream giver proud. Let's close our eyes this morning. I know the story told you so many things today, isn't it? I didn't have to give you principles, but you know what the story was telling you. Let that story begin to minister to you today. You see yourself in this journey of ordinary somewhere. You can identify with the ordinary. Whether it is right at the beginning in the familiar village or right at the end in the dream zone, in the promised land. All your questions are answered, can be answered. All your hurdles can be crossed. God helped the ordinary to achieve his dream. God helped the Israelites to move from slavery to become owners of a land. God has big dreams for ordinary people from unfamiliar places for his glory. Dream, start dreaming now. And you will find an amazing journey ahead. Choose to do something different from what you have done always. If you can do something different, you will get a different result this time. I just want to take time to pray for you, and then we'll go straight into the communion today, this being the first Sunday of this wonderful new year and the first month. We will thank Jesus for the possibility to dream again in our lives. For the possibility of having hope again. For the possibility of doing something with your life again. See, Christ made it possible for you. a joy, God, to see what you have in store for us. Amazing. To see that you know the journey. The entire journey that I need to take. And you see and you always prepared ahead for me. I had a dream, God, but I gave up because I thought I don't think I can do this. I don't think I can cross the wall. I had a dream. I pursued it for some time, but so many failures, so many disappointments. I don't think I can do it. That's where I am today. God, it's really hard to surrender, you know. This is my dream. I dreamt it. I fought for it. I worked hard for it. Now to give back to you, God, this is difficult. If there is somebody who's saying that is their position right now, I pray that you would help them to see you. Because only seeing you can convict us to surrender ourselves to you. God, if we are in the valley of giants and facing so many giants and darkness surrounding us, we are using all our strength, but we are not able to defeat this giant. Help them to trust in you and find source of strength from you, God. We know that this journey is not easy, but this is the journey we must take. This is the journey that changes our lives. This is the journey that's going to define us. I pray that each one, from young to the oldest, it's never too late to begin the journey. Help us to be convicted of that and then begin our journey, God. Dream. And we know now today that this dream, this journey is only possible, this adventure is only possible because Christ reconciled us back to the dream giver. We were not worthy, we were just ordinary people from unfamiliar places, but you chose to give us this wonderful dream, this big dream, because Christ did pay for us. That's why this path is possible now. Help us to grab hold, lay hold of what you have laid hold for us through Christ. And as we together as family remember what Christ has done for us, help us to be thankful. Well, it's because of the cross. It's because of the blood. It's because of the broken body. We can become dreamers. We can become somebody. We don't have to be ordinary. We can become somebody. We can become extraordinary. Because we have an extraordinary God who is willing to give big dreams, fulfill them through our lives for His glory. Thank you, God.